Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum everyone. I welcome you all to this important webinar to discuss the PIDE reform agenda for accelerated and sustained growth. It's an honor for AERC that we have with us very distinguished panel of economists to share their perspectives and comments on the topic of today's webinar. So first I'd like to introduce the honorable panelists. Starting from Dr. Hafiz Pasha. Pasha Saab actually needs no introduction. Pasha Saab is a professor emeritus at the Beacon House University, a teacher, a researcher, a mentor, and a hardcore technocrat. Pasha Saab has served as a United Nations Assistant Secretary General and United Nations Development Program Assistant Administrator and Director of the Regional Bureau for Asia and the Pacific. Pasha Saab was also the Federal Minister for Finance and Economic Affairs, Deputy Chairman of the Planning Commission of Pakistan with the status of a Federal Minister, Education Minister, and Commerce Minister in three governments. Pasha Saab has also served as the Vice Chancellor of the University of Karachi and the Director of AERC and IBA Karachi. I formally welcome you, sir, and thank you for your very graceful presence in this webinar. I like to mention here that Dr. Pasha has contributed extensively to the chapter on agenda for tax reforms in the PIDE reform agenda for growth. Our next honorable panelist is Dr. Parvez Tahir. He's a senior economist, distinguished professional writer and a speaker. Dr. Tahir has had a long career in the government of Pakistan as the Deputy Economic Advisor of Ministry of Finance, as Chief of Research and Debt Management in the Economic Affairs Division, and Chief Economist, Member of the Planning Commission, and acted as Secretary Planning and Development Division from 2000 to 2006. He has also served as the Managing Director of the Enercon and Energy Conservation. Dr. Tahir is the author of 2 and editor of 3 books. He has also published numerous journal and newspaper articles at home and abroad on a variety of subjects. And he has also served as the lecturer in economics at the Government College Lahore and visiting faculty at the Qaid-e-Azam University, Islamabad. Dr. Parvez Tahir has also contributed in the PIDE's document as member of PIDE Growth Commission. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us, Dr. Parvez Tahir. Dr. Idris Khwaja is a senior research economist at Pakistan Institute of Development Economics, who has done his postdoctorate from the Oxford University, University of California, Los Angeles, and has got the training on evidence-based decision-making from the Kennedy School of Government, Harvard University, USA. Dr. Khwaja was part of the PIDE Secretariat that was involved in preparation of the reform agenda for growth. And today he will discuss salient features of the document, which need to be spread for better understanding and the feedback of the concerned quarters. Ms. Sara Nizamani is a bright MPhil scholar of the AERC and research fellow of the IBA Karachi. She's a young thinking researcher with a strong passion to develop in-depth insight of issues in growth and development. She's also an honorary research fellow of PIDE. So with this introduction of our honorable panelists, with your permission, all of you, let me start off by saying that keeping aside the historical perspective and historical trends of ups and downs of the growth of the economy of Pakistan, in recent time and probably in recent decades also, we have witnessed growing militancy at home. Climate change impacts, like very serious floods and severe power outages. And also, we have also experienced the supply shortage of natural gas. We have also experienced, the industry of Pakistan has also experienced the weakening exports on account of continuing slowdown in the main markets for the country's merchandise and a weak foreign exchange position. I think all of these have dealt a very serious blow to investor confidence. And this has led to a very sharp reduction in investment and a slump in the rate of economic growth and sustained economic growth literally became a far cry. There is also an informal evidence of considerable amounts of capital flight from the country. The policy responses to all these challenges, they have not been effective. Noticeably in the area of tax collection, management of public enterprise losses, and also handling of the energy predicament and circular debt, etc. So many of the problems and issues that hinder steady progress towards the sustained high growth and financial stability, they are deep-seated, and they have also persisted for decades now. So while there are no silver bullets or the magical formula for solving structural problems, I think a broad agreement on the nature of the problems, a strong political will to undertake reforms, and initiation of critical steps would have significant payoff. So this will be the case even in the short and the medium term. I like to say that the efforts of the research institutes and the think tanks, like Pakistan Institute of Development Economics, is developing and documenting the growth strategy and reform agenda. I think it is a very commendable endeavor. And all concerned parties need to give a close attention to this document in order to make research-based policies towards achieving a very long-due, sustained, and definitely accelerated growth, as we are now seriously lagging behind in the region. So for this, I think the credit goes to the Vice Chancellor of PIDE, Dr. Nadeem Ul Haq. And now, with the permission of Dr. Pasha and Dr. Parvez Tahir, I first like to invite Dr. Idris Khwaja to please present the key features of the PIDE reform agenda for sustained and accelerated growth. Over to you, Dr. Idris Khwaja.
Thank you, Dr. Samina. So please let me know, am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Thank you. So thank you, Dr. Samina and AERC, for giving us the opportunity to explain the PIDE reform agenda here. And thank you also for gathering this distinguished panel, including Dr. Hafiz Pasha, Dr. Parvez Tahir, and Sara Nizamani. The process of developing the reform agenda began with the formation of PIDE Growth Commission by the Vice Chancellor of PIDE, Dr. Nadeem Ul Haq. And this included panelists from renowned economists from all over Pakistan, including from the practice as well as from the academia. And this included development practitioners as well. As I've already said, the two panelists, Dr. Hafiz Pasha and Dr. Parvez Tahir, extensively contributed to the discussions. So now let me move on to the end. The PIDE researchers basically acted as the secretariat. The round of consultation was such that first we developed a slide deck. The slide deck was discussed extensively. An outline was developed. And based on that outline, then we started doing the write-up. And then once the first draft of the write-up was ready, that write-up was shared again with the commission, and there were again extensive round of discussions. So almost many economists from all over Pakistan have contributed to the formulation of this PIDE reform agenda. This is not an exclusive effort of PIDE. It is the combined effort of a number of economists from all over Pakistan. So what was the central question that we began with? So our central question was, can Pakistan experience a sustained growth? And to answer this question, first me let take you to a brief recourse to some of the basic facts of Pakistan economy. Please let me know if I'm not audible.
You are, I think, audible. Me,
am I audible?
जी सर, आपकी आवाज आ रही है सर.
ठीक है, थैंक यू. सो दिस इज द ग्रोथ चार्ट ऑफ पाकिस्तान सिंस द 1950s, एंड टू ट्रेंड्स आर वेरी मच एविडेंट फ्रॉम हियर. नंबर वन, देयर आर बूम एंड बस्ट साइकल्स, And number two, the long-term trend of growth has declined. Same is the case with the next slide on about, this is about total factor productivity and gross fixed capital formation, or so to say the investment rate. Again, you can see that not only the two rates are low, these are on a declining course as well. This is the population trend of Pakistan, and these red bars show the working age population. So from this, these graphs, it is the youth bulge is evident. The working force that is entering the market is entering the market at an increasing rate. So in order to provide gainful employment to this labor force, Pakistan's need to grow at a very high rate, a sustained growth rate. PILS estimates suggest that we need to grow at a rate of around 7.1%. But please don't go into the numbers. It could be slightly less, it could be slightly more, but this shows that we need to grow at a high rate for a sufficiently long period. So, ye main aapko slide dikha raha tha, jee, ye, this slide is of population. These red bars, these show the growth rate of the working age population. That is of 15 to 64. So this slide basically shows the youth bulge of Pakistan. So in order to provide gainful employment to this youth, increasing labor force that is entering the market, PILS estimates suggest that we need to grow at a rate of 7.1%. per annum for a fairly long period of time. Please don't go into the numbers. It could be slightly less, slightly more, but this shows the direction that we need to go at a high rate. Now, let's move to the next slide. We have been going to the IMF very frequently, and we have been to the IMF 22 times in our history. And everybody knows that the debt to GDP of Pakistan is quite high. Currently, it is 86%. So now, in order to sustain debt, in order to repay our debt, again, we need to generate income. We need to grow at a high rate. Again, SPIDE estimates suggest that if we were to grow at a rate of 1.5%, which is equivalent to the real interest rate, then our debt would be increasing. This, please look at this blue line. If we were to grow at a rate of 4.5%, then please look at this gray line. We will be more or less maintaining our present level of debt. That is around 80% or something like this. And if we were to grow at a rate of 8%, then our debt to GDP would start declining. So again, this shows that we need to grow at a high rate for a sufficiently long period of time. Now, what should our growth strategy be? Given these two problems, that we are facing youth bulge and we are having a very high debt to GDP ratio. So to provide gainful employment to our labor force and to sustain our debt, what should our growth strategy be? The model that we have followed so far is of brick and mortar model that we call Huck and Hag model, developed by Dr. Mahbubul Haq during his time and the Harvard Advisory Group. This model might have been which focused on public investment, which focused on hard infrastructure. This might have served, would have been good in 60s and 70s when the economy needed a lot of infrastructure. But now with new knowledge coming in, with endogenous growth theory and all that, we know that now the world is focusing on institutions, rules, procedures, etc. So we need to change our growth paradigm. And what our growth paradigm should be, we should now be focusing beyond the infrastructure to the software of growth as well. And that software of growth is institutions, that is laws, rules, and processes. And why I'm saying that we should be focusing on this is that, as I've said, that our productivity is low and our investment is low, so we need reforms. Reforms in our procedures, our systems, etc., to increase our productivity, If you manage to increase our productivity, this would increase the return on investment, and this would curb the barriers to investment. And when these, when the return to investment increases, and when the barriers to investment are addressed, then this would improve our interest rate. हम सुनते रहते हैं कि फलां शख्स बाहर से आया, उसने बहुत इन्वेस्टमेंट की कोशिश की और फिर वो दिल बर्दाश्ता होके चला गया कि उसको फलां फलां जगह जो है इन्वेस्टमेंट में बॉटल नेक्स्ट जो है फेस करने पड़े। तो हमारा कहने का मतलब ये है कि ये बॉटल नेक्स्ट जो है एड्रेस करने की ज़रूरत है। एक छोटी सी मिसाल ले लें कि अगर एक शख्स रिटायर होता है, he would take, it would take years, at least 1 or 2 years before he gets his pension dues. What would he do with his pension? The chances are that he would invest somewhere or build a house for himself or herself. So wo investment activity jo pension dues se generate honi hai wo delay ho jati hai, wo slow ho jati hai. So if we can speed up the payment of just pension dues, this would increase the investment rate. This is just one small example. I am giving this example because a lot of government servants might be sitting here, so they can relate to this. In we would be, though we are saying it that we need to grow at a 7 to 9% rate, but please remember that this is the required rate. This is the rate required to stay out of the woods, to stay out of the difficulties. However, we are not projecting, we are not giving any projected rate that if these reforms happen, then the country would be going at a rate of 7%, 8%, because there are difficulties in predicting a rate. There are several limitations of projection models. And then growth, of course, is not linear. Then there is always a debate between market and government, whether the growth effort should be led by the market or by the government. You know, what we are saying is that the market and the government supplement each other. They are a part and parcel of each other, because it is the government which establishes the rule of the games, and which not only develops the rules of the game, but which also enforces the rules of the game. These rules of the game are enforced through the judiciary, through the regulatory agencies, and so on and so forth. And if these rules are not to be enforced, then there would be a number of problems. The market competitors would not have a level playing field, and there could be other number of other problems as well. So we are not saying that it's market or government. Rather, we are saying that the both together would help the country to grow. So the next slide is about sector versus systemic approach. I would like to emphasize here that we are not picking any particular sector of the economy as propeller of growth. We are not saying that the government should encourage the IT sector or the agriculture sector and so on and so forth. Rather, we are in favor of a level playing field for everyone, and we are of the opinion that let the market pick up the winners. If the market says that the returns to investment are higher in the IT sector, then let the IT sector be the winner. And the market says that the returns to investment in the agriculture sector are higher, then let the agriculture sector be the winner. Okay. So what should be the framework for growth? This could be sort of a general framework that on the top is the government. The government provides policy, laws, rules, regulations. And of course, and this is the software of the society, software of the economy, Dr. Nasser. And then, of course, a certain infrastructure is also required, and we need a certain special configuration of the cities to be conducive for growth. And then the other agents in the market are basically is the society, which has three components. That is the market, civil society, and the academia. And then there are drivers of growth. The drivers of growth are basically the ideas, the institutions that I've already discussed, policy rules, etc. And of course, in this age of technology, we cannot forget the technology as a driver of growth. So if these things are in place, then the market, then the society would generate opportunities, entrepreneurial opportunities, which would be conducive for growth, and growth would happen. Now, analyzing the software. What are the impediments to investment? Because I have said in the very beginning, Pakistan investment rate is very low and it's declining as well. So what are the impediments to investment? There's a footprint of the government in the economy. There is sludge, which is excessive frictions. Then there is rent seeking. And then there is policy instability. I will be discussing these slides ahead. Government footprint. Wide estimates suggest that the government footprint in the economy is around 67% of GDP. So now, by footprint, we mean that the government is an active player in the economy. Rather than being an enabler, the government is actually doing businesses, running businesses in energy sector, in transportation, financial, trading, manufacturing, and even advocacy. The largest bank is owned by the government, that is the National Bank. And to an extent, the government departments are required to maintain their deposits with the National Bank of Pakistan. So now National Bank have an edge over rest of the market players. The rest of the market players, other banks have to make an effort to attract customers, whereas the National Bank has captive customers. Same could be the case with the airline. The largest airline is owned by the government. Then the government fixes prices of a number of commodities. As an economist, we know that fixing prices is not good economics. And the government is fixing prices of wheat, electricity, gas, medicine, and even milk and bread. And then there are restrictive regulations. If you want to build a high rise, it is not very easy. Some of the cities would not even allow it. And those that would allow it, it can take years to get a permission. The government is regulating the pharmaceutical market to the extent that the government had not allowed increase in prices for over a decade. And a number of MNCs in the pharmaceutical sector have left Pakistan. So basically, these restrictive regulations, we are saying that the government is there to regulate, but government is over-regulating. And due to this, this thing is killing competition. Next word is sludge. Sludge is basically a concept propounded by Nobel laureate Cass Sunstein. There are a number of, if you want to develop a housing society, you need at least 20 new NOCs. Of course, the government has to regulate the development sector, the housing societies, but probably one or two permissions would be enough. If they have to seek 22 permissions, probably they would have to spend 2 to 3 years in getting those permissions. Same is the case with tax compliance. If you want to pay taxes, it would take a businessman and an SME around 577 hours in a year and 47 procedures to pay all the taxes. 17 permissions are required to open a cinema. And a couple of days ago, we had a webinar on Internet for All, and they told us that to lay up optic fiber, they need 45 permissions, have to go through 45 steps. All this is constraining business environment. So what we are saying is that focus on this software. If these 45 steps could be reduced to 5 steps, probably this would encourage business activity. This would increase business activity, and this would be conducive for growth. So that's why we are saying that focus on the software of growth. Of course, hardware is important. But now software is getting more and more important given that there are all these restrictions. And then, of course, there is rent-seeking, which kills the competitive environment, which kills the level playing field. And these are the various instruments of seeking grants through SROs and through tax concessions and through import restrictions, et cetera. So what should be our, how our state should be configured to provide an enabling environment to the marketplace? There should be policy making bodies, basically the federal government and the provincial governments should primarily be concerned with policy making. And of course, this policy making is to be fed by research. And that there should be regulatory bodies who again make their decisions based on research and based on monitoring and evaluation. Today, somebody has developed a vaccine policy. So somebody is evaluating how that, and that policy is functioning. Okay. So I was talking about three elements of the reform, that is the informed policy making and the market regulations. And then the service delivery is basically has to be focused to be delegated to the local governments, which are not very much functioning in Pakistan right now. Service delivery has to be with the local government because local governments are closer to the people. Then the electoral system. I will only briefly talk about this. We need to rethink what should be the counters of the electoral system. This has to be debated, but we need to rethink our first past the post system. We need to talk about whether or not there should be term limits for the prime minister and the legislature, the necessity of local government. And we have to also talk about campaign financing. You have sunte rehte hain, foreign funding case, et cetera, et cetera. All these arises because kuch dusri countries ne jo hai campaign financing wagaira ko generate karne ko legalize kiya hua hai, hamare yahan hamare mulk mein wo jo hai nahi. Develop public sector capacity. We often hear things like Ricodec, Kake, LNG contracts happening. All these are the contracts that have gone wrong. The reason is that the primary reason is the weak state capacity. So we have to develop state capacity to negotiate, not only negotiate mega contracts, but to function effectively and efficiently. And then we have to develop a regulatory capacity as well, of the regulatory capacity of NEPRA, PEMBRA, Competition Commission, etc. We have these laws that regulate our regulatory agencies, but these laws have been developed not by ourselves, not by Pakistani community. These have been developed by international lending agencies, World Bank, etc. So we need to develop a regulatory capacity as well. So what should be the counter we need to have a modern civil service to begin with. And the reforms that I've listed here, you almost everyone would be aware of these, most of people, because these have been widely discussed in different forums. Dr. Ishrat Hussain is leading the effort on reforms. But I would just mention that first of all, we need to think about the main problem in public sector is job security. Since people have lifetime employment, therefore there is not much incentive to work. Then we cannot hire the senior people, professionals at a higher level. You can enter the civil servants only at grade 17. So even if you have hired a person who has a degree in, let's say, computer science in grade 17, he 30 years ago, he might not help you with the artificial intelligence, etc. today, because those things were not there while he was in the academic field. So we need to hire people directly at higher grades, grade 21, 22, or 19. And these are the proposals already being discussed. So these are just some of the reforms. then we need to have performance agreements. Now coming to transaction cost. Transaction cost in Pakistan are very high. If two businessmen, two entrepreneurs run into a dispute, they have to approach the court. And you know the situation in our courts, it can take years and years to resolve the dispute. Of course, this would discourage investment in the country. This would constrain business activity in the country. So we need to resolve our judicial challenges. I've discussed these in these slides, but these are, you need to have a merit-based system for judges. You need to have something to do with that the stay orders do not run for ages and so on and so forth. These are the reforms that we need in our judicial system. Then we need strategic intervention in at least four sectors, what we call four verticals, which are interconnected. That is agriculture, energy, real estate, cities. If you would say that there is one problem that is constraining business activity in Pakistan and that is increasing the cost of doing business and competitiveness, harming competitiveness in Pakistan, that is the energy sector. So we need to resolve all the issues that are constraining, that are making energy expensive in Pakistan and that are constraining the development of energy. Real estate is a very vibrant sector in a number of economies, but real estate market is not functioning in Pakistan because to have a market, the first thing that in market you need is information. And if you go to buy, let's say, exchange currency today, buy dollars against rupees, you won't be worried that you will be taken for a ride. Someone would sell you dollars for 165 rupees because you can check the going rate on the internet and then approach the market. But this is not the case with the real estate. If you go to dealer X, we would call you 1 crore and the another dealer would call 1.5 crore. So if there was some mechanism to be developed where the prices of going prices are known to the people, then this would encourage trading and this is possible. The government has the prices, the realtors have the prices. If they were just to disclose their prices on which the transactions are being executed, this would develop, market price. The market price would be known to the market, and even indices of a real estate market can be developed. Cities, then almost all these markets, that is the input market, land market, output market, storage market, forward market, and downstream market in the agriculture sector are either almost absent or these are not functioning. So we need to again develop the rules and regulations and provide the information to facilitate the functioning of these markets. Electricity sector is completely unviable. Circular debt is ballooning. And then, so we need to address the issue of circular debt and we need to address the governance of the sector. Probably one way out about the governance would be the decentralization, handing over the discourse to the provinces. It would be very difficult to privatize the energy sector because of the monopoly nature of the discourse. But at least we can think about decentralization. But all these issues are that require further debate. In the real estate sector, there's issue of land titling. It's very much fragmented. There is again issue of dispute settlement. If you run into a dispute on real estate, one can imagine that how long it would take in courts. So what is needed is a secure titling, secure contracting, remove the sludge in the functioning of the market, and develop the brokerage industry. That is the brokerage industry in the real estate sector, and make it rather more formal. There could be e-listing of the sector. There could be an association of the realtors, which can develop rules and regulations, as there are association of lawyers, as there are association of chartered accountants. There can be association of realtors as well, which can develop a code of conduct for the functioning of the realtors. Rethinking cities. PIDE has done a lot of work on cities. So I will briefly say that our cities have to be dense, our cities have to be walkable, our cities should be vertical, because these sprawls are basically eating up our into our infrastructure. We have to supply energy to far off places. We have to take road to far off places. This is increasing our travel time. And all this is contributing to decline in productivity. All this is eating up into productivity. Unlock debt capital. What is debt capital? Debt capital is that we are not using our property very efficiently. If we were to take a round of the from the Constitution Avenue in Islamabad to, let's say, the Minister Enclave, etc., you can see hordes of properties that are underutilized. Take the convention center. Take the Jinnah Stadium. Are we using Jinnah Stadium? Are we using convention center? And throughout there, you would see just two-story buildings, where in these corners can go up to 40 stories. Street vending. Street vending is a very much pro-poor activity, pro-poor entrepreneurial activity. And this is, street vendors are seen almost allwhere in East Asia, in New York, in Washington, etc., everywhere. But we look upon the street vendors as encroachers. PIDE has been advocating this topic, and there has been some success on this. And this ESAS program of Dr. Sanya Nishtar has taken up this initiative, and now street vendors could be seen under a formal setup in G11 Islamabad, and a law perhaps is on the anvil for the street vendors to let the street vendors operate without any fear. We need to have a car policy. We are basically, by constructing these roads, signal-free corridors, flyovers, etc., we are basically subsidizing cars. Everywhere on government property, you would see cars being parked freely. So this could be not only a source of revenue for the city government, but you can have congestion tolls, etc. This would not only generate revenue for the city's authority, this would also reduce congestion in the cities. Again, a pro-poor activity would be that wherever you see that the apartments are sold, these are sold with parking. If we have to make our cities inclusive, if we have to provide space in the cities for the poor people, then we should think about selling these apartments without parking, because those who don't want to own a car, or those who cannot afford to own a car, still they can own an apartment. These are some of the cross-cutting themes. Openness, internet access. Internet access now is probably should be treated as a fundamental right. I've written on this as well, that if we were to provide internet in far-flung areas, you cannot imagine the benefits of telemedicine, of e-commerce in rural areas, people sending their crops, people sending their handicrafts, etc., directly to the market in the cities. And of course, then there is online education and everything. on taxation, yes, let me talk about something taxation, but Dr. Pasha has written this chapter and Dr. Pasha will talk more about this. So there should be three heads basically only: income tax, corporate tax, GST. We are proposing that all tax should be taxed similarly. There shouldn't be different rate for different incomes. Withholding regime, most of the Pakistan's revenue, tax revenue, is currently being generated through withholding taxes. And of course, from the hordes of taxes, there are only 10 or 11 taxes that are paying revenue. So rest of this can be taken off to simplify the tax regime. Transactions should not be taxed other than GST, simplified documentation, and electronic unified databases. So this is about taxation reform. And then for excises, for environment and other special purposes, capital gains should be taxed at a lower rate, ranging from 15% to 5%, depending on the length of the holding period. And so this is something about taxation reforms. Then finally, preparing for the future. In future, some of this artificial intelligence and technology not only creating jobs, it is also destroying some jobs. Leaders of the world tomorrow would be those who can use technology. So what we need to do is that we need to brace for the coming age. We need to disrupt our education system to graduate creative youths and educated youth who can take advantage of the coming age of technology and artificial intelligence. So I think I would close here. Finally, so the summary would be that what we need to do is that we need to develop a software for growth, which would be laws, rules, processes that would facilitate rather than constrain transactions. We have to go for good governance, build state capacity, do research, rely on monitoring and evaluation-based policy, an efficient civil service, an efficient judiciary, take care of the sludge in the market, footprint of the government in the market, have vibrant cities, and prepare for the disruption to embrace the age of technology and artificial intelligence. One question that would arise is, I want to preempt this question and answer this question: who will implement the reforms? This question is often asked, that all these reforms are very good, but who will implement this? My answer would be, I recently read a historian, Dr. Mubarak Ali. In a foreword to a book, he says that there are three stages of reform, of implementing the reform. The first stage is the thought reconstruction or idea generation process and through research. So basically what we are doing, those three reform agenda, is we are generating an idea. We are throwing up an idea. We are trying to reconstruct thought. The next stage, Dr. Mubarak Ali says, is convincing the market players and whosoever are to implement the reforms, that is of three and thought reconstruction, to create an enabling environment, because there would be some people who would genuinely believe that these reforms suggested would not work. And then there would be another set of people who might lose from reform. All reforms generate, institutions and economics literature says that all reforms generate losers and winners. In some cases, the would-be losers might be large in number or might be a few in numbers, but very powerful. So we would have to overcome this pressure. We would have to overcome the disadvantage that the would-be losers would incur. So we have to, number one, those who genuinely believe that these reforms would not work, we have to convince them through constant debate, through constant advocacy, that, you know, look, this is the logic, these reforms would work. And this is the task that the academia has to do. And then the third stage is of the implementation, that would be the government agencies and the marketplace. So probably right now we are at the first stage, that is of throwing in ideas. And basically we are saying is that this PIDE reform agenda is not only a reform agenda, this is also a research agenda. Because when I say that there are 22 NOCs are required for land development, I also don't know which NOC can be taken off, which NOC can be eliminated. Me and you have to do this research together to find out which of the sludge steps, which of the NOC can be taken off, and advise the powers that be, advise the government that, look, this is an extra step, this is an unnecessary step, this can be taken off. This is how the reforms would be implemented. Thank you. Thank you for a patient hearing.
Thank you so much, Dr. Idris Khwaja, for your presentation, telling us about the salient features of the reform agenda of PIDE. And you are very right that we really have to go a long way till the implementation of the reforms that you have talked about. Now, I would like to request Dr. Hafiz Pasha. Sir, you are the author of Growth and Inequality in Pakistan, Agenda for Reforms. You have written a very comprehensive book on the topic of growth and your perspective on PIDE's reform agenda. It will be very valuable for us, very educating and learning experience. So I look forward to listening to you. And that would be really something which we are going to treasure, not only for our students, but also who are listening. And we are going to share this video with all those people who are going to be listening to you and also learning from your discourse. Thank you so much, sir.
Can you hear me? Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Thank you, Samina, for organizing this wonderful event. Let me also say that the cooperation between PIDE and AERC is something which is totally welcomed, and inshallah you should begin to be doing some research also together, and your faculty and student programs should also be, if possible, possibly encouraged and integrated. So this is a wonderful step forward, Samina, and we appreciate this. Now, what has happened is that Idris, in his very comprehensive introduction to the strategy, focused on two aspects of growth: accelerated and sustained growth. So the two key words were accelerated and sustained. Let me, if you allow me, add inclusive growth. So I'm talking in terms of three dimensions of growth: accelerated, sustained, and inclusive. Now, in order to give you a handle on this, some of the recent research that we have done as part of the National Human Development Report for the UN, we have come up some recent estimates of the extent of inequality in our country. The key finding is that Pakistan is characterized by somewhat higher inequality than some of other countries which are at a similar stage of development. After adjusting for massive underreporting in the household integrated economic surveys and so on, we find that the simple ratio of between the top 20% and the bottom 20% of the population in Pakistan is as high as 7-1. So this is a fairly high degree of inequality, a Gini coefficient which is approaching 0.42. The official estimates are that it's somewhere in the early 30s. The other very strong indicator of inequality in Pakistan is if you look at some of the particular areas. For example, you look at the agricultural census data, 1% of our largest farmers own 22% of the land. This is really a very, very skewed agricultural land distribution. The other indicator is the ownership of property. In the urban areas, the top 1% of the households own something like 16% of the property. So in fact, Pakistan has witnessed, and it's very interesting, the relationship between growth and inequality. Generally, we have seen that periods of high growth have been accompanied by rising inequality. And that is why precisely when you focus on an accelerated and sustained growth, you need to be able to ensure that it does not lead to a breakdown in terms of greater inequality, which could eventually frustrate it like we saw in the 60s, when at the end of that wonderful period of high growth, we saw the loss of East Pakistan and we saw the emergence of the 22 families. So even the sustainability issue is linked to the inclusiveness of growth. And in that context, there are, of course, many dimensions to this. But today, given the time available to me, I will focus exclusively on the tax reform agenda, which is going to be, we hope, progressive in nature and also revenue yielding in character. Now, this is also very topical, if you like, because day after tomorrow, looking forward to the federal budget for 21-22. Which is going to be an extremely important budget because it represents, hopefully, a transition from low to somewhat higher growth and also perhaps to some degree of relief to the people of our country. When you look at the strategy that has already been proposed, I must profess to a great deal of disappointment. The resource mobilization strategy, which we have agreed to with the International Monetary Fund as part of the sixth review, is unfortunately extremely difficult to implement and defective. Two key dimensions, which just tells me how bankrupt we are in terms of conceiving of the reforms. The first is target the sales tax schedules. In the Sales Tax Act, there are at least 11 such schedules, and remove exemptions and low rates of taxation. The prime candidates which emerge from this examination are items like fertilizer, which is being taxed at 2%, LNG, which is being taxed at 12%, cotton, which is being taxed at 10%, so on. Are these the items you want to levy 17% rate on? In fact, fertilizer, we should be offering a subsidy to promote agriculture when fertilizer costs have gone up by 30%. The other area that is being focused on is the withdrawal of fiscal incentives for investment, the withdrawal of the initial depreciation allowance, the withdrawal of the tax credit on balancing modernization and replacement. This is bizarre at a time when Pakistan wants to stage a stronger recovery. The IMF and the government have agreed to withdraw all fiscal incentives to investment. This is, to me, frankly, completely uncalled for. I can proudly claim to have been the father of these incentives in the 90s. And during the Musharraf era, we saw a huge benefit in terms of a massive expansion in textile sector capacity, which has helped us even now. Unfortunately, capacity has not been expanding so rapidly in recent years in our export sectors. So what is it that we need to do? My own view is that get out of the indirect taxation mode, get out of the need to withdraw fiscal incentives. Progressive taxation is the answer. And let me tell you that the research that I've done with my students here at BNU, there is enormous fiscal space available for raising progressive tax revenues. I'll give you two or three dramatic examples. One, the favorite example is agriculture income tax. This is a tax which has been retarded in its development because of the extremely powerful rural elite. who dominate particularly the provincial assemblies because agricultural income tax is a provincial subject. Now, I was able to get this law passed in 1997 with great difficulty, but it has remained largely moribund since then. The net revenues accruing, or rather income accruing to the top 1% of our farmers who own 22% of the land, net, very, very cautiously, carefully estimated, is 700 billion rupees. Net of everything. And do you know how much revenue they are contributing through the agricultural income tax to the provincial exchequers? 2.5 billion rupees. 0.4%. The other example is the very, very affluent large urban property owners, including, with all due respects, the properties in the Defense Housing Authorities of Pakistan. Some of the best properties today are located in those neighborhoods. The net rent generated by the top 20% of the households in terms of property ownership is estimated at anywhere between 600 to 900 billion rupees, particularly if you include commercial properties, which are also subject to taxation. How much revenue are we collecting through the rental income tax? How much revenue are we collecting through the urban immovable property tax? Total 26 billion rupees. That is 26 out of the lower figure of 7, it's less than 4%. And these are the most affluent households with properties stretching over number of canals. Or as you know, in Pakistan, we have different measures. So in the Punjabi context, it's like maybe 25, 30 marlas. So there is a huge amount of potential for progressive income taxation in Pakistan. So what we did was we have quantified the tax expenditures. Tax expenditures basically is the revenue loss due to privileges and concessions embodied in the law. So it's not that they're outside the law. We are not getting into issues of tax evasion here. We are talking about formal relief in the taxation system to the very affluent, the so-called elite of this country, sometimes referred to by our honorable Prime Minister as the wonderful mafiosi. Now the issue is, what is the quantum of tax expenditure by a particular privileged group in Pakistan? Let me give you some of the numbers, and they are truly shocking. The tax breaks which have been given to the feudal elite, including direct as well as indirect taxes on inputs and so on, add up to 205 billion rupees annual relief. The corporate sector, including all kinds of protection, exemptions, lower sales tax rates, lower presumptive income tax, exports, transfer pricing, under invoicing, so on and so forth. Both financial, the corporate sector of Pakistan is a net beneficiary of all these tax benefits of 428 billion rupees. The large traders, here I'm not talking about their evasion, I'm talking about what they legitimately should be paying through the tax system. They have an extremely low presumptive income tax on electricity bills. We have very low withholding taxes on commercial importers. They have imports and they enjoy tax benefits, large traders, of 226 billion rupees. I can go on. Let me just add one more group, and that is the high net worth persons. who enjoy all kinds of tax credits. And frankly, give you one dramatic example of the break given to the high income net worth persons of Pakistan. There is no concept of comprehensive income taxation in Pakistan. They have managed to get the income into blocks and subject to final taxation. So if there is a very rich person who owns assets and who has deposits and property also, he pays on his interest income separately, block income, 10%. That's it. Allah, Allah, khair, sallah. His marginal tax rate may be 25, 30, but on interest income, fixed and final, 10%. On dividends, fixed and final, 5 to 10%. That's it. He may be the owner of that particular establishment or company. His marginal rate may be 30%, but he pays 5 to 10%. Similarly, capital gains, 5 to 15%. So on, the simplest thing which requires one paragraph change in the law is that henceforth, personal income tax will be levied on total income, earned and unearned. And these current fixed and final liabilities will only be in the nature of advance taxes and not final. You just do this, just one step. That is all that is required. Mind you, you'll have to contend with a very powerful vested interest. But if you can do this, this alone gives you 200 to 250 billion rupees. And believe it or not, September last year, the Honorable Prime Minister of Pakistan had invited his old tutor, Dr. Pasha, to speak on the progressivity of the income tax system. I told him all this, and there were about 25 people there, and so on and so forth. And I'm pleased to report to you that his assistant who was there, a boy called Rizwan, he was writing down the number of times the Prime Minister said, very good idea, very good idea. It turned out that 40 times the Prime Minister said, very good idea, very good idea. What is the status of implementation? Zero. This is the powerful vested entrenched interest of Pakistan. They will not pay extra taxes. They want this 10% to continue on interest income, this 5% to continue on dividends. Why should they pay their normal marginal tax rate? So we are contending with a very powerful elite which has been able to get all kinds of tax breaks. So I have in fact drafted a comprehensive tax agenda linked to the issue of progressivity leading to additional revenues of 3 to 4% of the GDP, which would be about 1500 to 2000 billion rupees, which we would then be able to use for purposes of pushing up our development, infrastructure spending, providing relief to the poor, particularly at this time when inflation rates are at extremely high levels. But I must say, at the fag end of my life and career, I am not optimistic about the prospects for achieving sustainable, accelerated growth combined with inclusiveness. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir, for this. I wouldn't call it a pessimistic view or the pessimistic kind of a scenario that you have explained to us, but the recommendations that you have given, they are really very laudable. But the question remains, who is going to implement them? If they accept it, the Prime Minister, as you said, that he was really appreciating all these the recommendations that were given to him. But is Prime Minister able to, or is he powerful enough to implement these recommendations? That sounds very, very laudable, very practical, and result oriented. I'm not sure about it. But Dr. Pasha, taking the advantage of your presence, I really like to, before I go to Dr. Parviz Tahir's, before I invite him, I'd like to draw your attention towards few points which are going to be given to us. I mean, these steps and these measures by the government in day after tomorrow's budget that they are going to announce. The spending side, that sustainable and inclusive growth that you talked about, protecting the poor and the vulnerable, and also containing the inflation through a freeze on administrative prices of energy. This is one of the measures that they have talked about. And increased development spending for job creation and minimal increase in current expenditure, that will be the key objectives for the government in the next budget. But the slogan that the government has come up this year for this budget, that the growth has to come from the production sector and not the consumption sector. Like the finance minister has recently said that the government will provide incentives to 12 production sectors in the coming federal budget that have been identified to achieve inclusive and sustainable growth. This is very clearly he has mentioned in one of his television interview. So in the Economic Advisory Council that had, the meeting was held on the 1st of June, the finance minister agreed to the extent to the fixed cheaper power rate to industry till October 2023. So basically the government is aiming to target the growth rate of 4.8% for the next year. And the annual plan coordinating committee, APCC, they expect the agriculture production to grow 3.4%, industrial output to grow by 6.8%, and manufacturing 6.2%, and services by 4.7%. Do you think all these measures and expectations, if realized in letter and spirit, could put the country on the trajectory of higher growth probably from next year? I mean, this is a
very relevant set of questions, and I'm glad you've done such thorough analysis of recent developments, Samina. The issue is our relationship with what I might like to refer to as Uncle IMF. The issue is, you 3 months ago, you go and have a comprehensive agreement with the International Monetary Fund on resumption of the program, completion of the second and the fifth reviews, moving on to the sixth review, and Uncle IMF also releases $500 million. It's all based on a detailed set of actions agreed on and reforms. Based on that, in April, the government brings out what is called the medium-term budget strategy paper, which essentially replicates the understandings in detail with the IMF program. And then suddenly, one of our former teachers at AERC, Dr. V. Sheikh, is sacked. And in his place, we have then now a Dabang banker called Tareen. The issue is, are we willing to now take on a head-on confrontation with the IMF? And if I can speak off the cuff slightly, are we willing to offer bases to the United States of America to give us free money like happened 20 years ago? So the issue is, if that is not the case, there is a denial this morning, although the New York Times had published that Pakistan has offered bases to the US. The issue is, if not, then the IMF may suspend the program, which is fine. Then you have to have your homegrown program. You'll have to go for much more intensive taxation. You will have to go for much more control of the current account. You will have to depreciate the rupee more. You will have to cut back on all non-essential imports. Wonderful. And forget about this 2.1 trillion PSDP spending. This year, you will hardly spend 1 trillion or 1.2 trillion. So The whole thing is up in the air, and that is the reason why the date for the presentation of the budget still has not yet actually been fully finalized. My own feeling is that the government has to say once and for all that this IMF program that we signed on to is just not doable. We cannot raise tariffs by 35%. We can't bring petroleum money back to 30 rupees. We cannot raise revenues by 1163 billion. We can't do this. We can't do that. We can't do this. Otherwise, forget the possibility of a relatively high rate of growth if we remain within the contours of the agreed budget strategy with the IMF. This is my own view, that the whole environment today is extremely uncertain until such time it becomes clear as to what is going to be our relationship with the IMF.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much for your answer. I think some of the questions would come later for you. Now, I would like to invite Dr. Parvez Tahir. And I'd like to say, sir, that you have worked on very important positions in economic policy making circles. So what, in your opinion, went wrong? I'd like to listen to your perspective on the historically speaking, that why we have never been able to achieve sustained and accelerated growth of the economy, and what are those critical factors that retarded the growth of nation's economy off and on. So over to you, sir.
Thank you, Shamina. I get the feeling.
Aria, please.
Okay. Well, I will only say once to Hafiz, very good idea. And I will say to Idris, very good to have mentioned Mubarak Ali, an indigenous historian. And if you really want to know about implementation, you should read the book entirely. Now, I get the feeling, Samina, that we are the lost tribe of growth. You know, we used to say we are ahead of South Korea. Then we used to say we are ahead of Malaysia. And then we used to say we are ahead of Vietnam. And where we are, well, we now know that we are way behind Bangladesh, our own lost province. They have learned how to grow. We have not. And what is the problem? If you look at your budget, where is it spent? One of the members of the advisory council you mentioned made a presentation which says, well, the largest claimant are the bankers. And then there is the security establishment. And those Hafiz wanted to include get a fitting. And Pied has prepared a strategy. The issue is someone going to listen? We are at a stage now where we are debating whether our recovery is V-shaped or some other shape. In fact, talking of V-shape, you know, a V-shape requires that your growth has returned to your baseline. It hasn't. The recovery seems to be U-shaped. It will take a year or two to return to the baseline. But we are, you know, really having a lot of fun that we are now on the road to growth. And the kind of things we hear in the government don't make sense. You know, the organization concerned with growth is Planning Commission. I think they neither have the capacity to make plans nor the intellectual desire to listen to advice. Growth is in the hands of those who basically look at ways to raise some revenue so that rigid priorities are met. And that is where Ankur, as he said, comes in. Now the Ankur is of course the representative of the banks we talked about. We did have, we did accelerate growth at some point, but we could not sustain it. And inclusive it never was. Now, inclusion actually is an important element of sustainability. You know, growth has to be politically sustainable also. And that happens only when you include the left out. And you will never have the kind of growth you need if you do not turn the left out into growth makers. And that is the art of accelerated, sustained, inclusive growth. I do not see any move, repeat, any move toward expanding let's say the group of growth makers. We only know that we give some incentives to some industry and they will go, and we should give some subsidies to agriculture and we will get growth. We do not have any thinking beyond that. And that is our problem. The gap is in thinking. The gap is in politics. As for economics, you know, you can always get ideas from economists. I think that is the main point I want to make. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much, sir. It's a really very important point, very relevant one as well. So now over to Sarah. Sarah, are you ready for your presentation?
Thank you, Dr. Simina. Am I audible and visible?
Yes, you are. To me, at least. I think for others as well.
Thank you, Dr. Simina. I would like to begin with thanking AERC and especially Dr. Simina for providing this and many other opportunities. Without her commitment to the center, many of us would not be where we are today. It's an absolute honor to be here with Dr. Pasha, Dr. Tahir, and Dr. Idris. I would also like to mention that I'm one of the few lucky scholars who at the beginning of their career are lucky enough to be associated with the three best institutes in this country, which is IBA, AERC, and PIDE, where I'm serving as an honorary fellow. I'm using this platform to express my gratitude to the mentors who have aided this process. Coming to the report, now I'll try to keep it as brief as possible, as my comments are not as technical as Dr. Pasha's or as accurate as Dr. Tahir's, but my aim is to provide a youth perspective to this strategy. PIDE has done a remarkable job by producing this report and making this culture of debate and research a necessity. Unfortunately, research has never been demanded by our policymakers. No think tanks are connected to our parliament. Apparently they know it all. However, this supply of knowledge that our institutes are creating hopefully will create its own demand. Coming to the report, I will talk about four things that can be added or edited in the strategy to aid the process of rapid growth. And the first one I want to talk about is the role of women and how they can revive this economy. The document does talk about female labor force participation. However, I believe that it does not recognize that one reason Pakistan remains so poor is the unrealized contribution of women in this country. Women are 50% of our population, but only 20% of our working population. Of those who work, 66% of them are in agriculture, where they are unpaid family workers. 7% have bank accounts, and 3% can copy-paste something on a computer. This shows all a systematic discrimination. Certainly more of our girls are going to school and university, but for what? About only 27% have university bachelor's or higher degree, and only out of those 7%, only 25% work outside their homes. Unfortunately, the society is educating women, but not to find suitable jobs or for higher standard of livings, but for suitable wedlocks. For those who work in the informal sectors, they have absolutely poor pays and no rights. And those who work in the formal sectors first have to convince their parents and then their in-laws. And then there are also uncountable benefits beyond the obvious economic ones. Women who work are likelier to have fewer children. That controls the problem of population. They invest more in the children's upbringing. That promotes education and civic sense. And then they have more to say in their lives. If Pakistan needs economic reforms, it needs a plan like Japan's Shinzo Abe's, which incentivizes and cushions motherhood, justice, security for women. There are plenty of remarkable examples to follow, like Vietnam, Bangladesh. And if we don't do this soon, before we know, Saudi women will be more common in workplace than Pakistani ones. The second issue I would like to raise is related to agriculture. Dr. Nadeem is often critical of my interest in rural areas and argues that cities are the future of Pakistan. But is it really this case, sir? Are 65% people live in rural areas? Do we expect the entire country to move to the cities? The document mentions that government must leave the wheat and sugar market. There's absolutely no doubt that government should leave the sugar market. Sugarcane is a water-intensive crop. It's costly to produce. It takes 18 months to harvest. It is grown by mega landowners. Sugar also has cheap alternatives available. So exiting that market is a good idea. But wheat market, more often than not, wheat in international market is more expensive than Pakistan market. The government intervention should have two objectives. Number one, price stability for the farmers. And number two, targeted assistance through supply to the bottom 15 to 20% of the population. The Chinese poverty alleviation program, which inspires the prime minister largely, also has a similar kind of a program where people work for the government and in return, they get food beside their incomes. This is different than the Langar Khana model. Dr. Pasha here can guide us better if something like this is possible or not. Also, I would like to point out that every government tells us that how agriculture is the backbone of this country. But for some reason, they are not able to fix their own backbone. Roshan Digital Account, which is something the government is quite proud of, has option to invest in bonds, real estate, stock market, but again, not agriculture. Similarly, whenever physical infrastructure of Pakistan is discussed, infrastructure includes power sector, roads, ports, sewage, but not irrigation and drainage, which is arguably the most important physical infrastructure for Pakistan. The hilarious thing is that all these influential people in parliament are mostly agriculturists and mega landowners. But the paradox is that they themselves don't know how to fix their own sectors. Perhaps Dr. Pasha can shed some light on this paradox once I finish. The best government has to offer is subsidies and dole outs, while what farmers actually need is capitalism to work for them, which means capital accumulation, competitive markets, price systems, property rights, research, and market-based finance. Don't know how the government plans to fix all this through a Kisan card. Agriculture is a competitive advantage. It needs to work for Pakistan to work. The third thing I want to point out is youth and its opportunities. It's funny how the government shows concern when youth is unemployed, but when they finally find a way to earn, the government shows a remarkable ability to hurt the already existing market. The document does talk about internet for all, which is an excellent thing for to advocate, but it is missing a bigger injustice which is about to happen. I'm talking about texting freelancers over here. A simple Google search will show you that despite COVID-19, Pakistani freelancers earned $150 million in financial year 2019 and 20 through web development, softwares, and application, etc. Please note, this is earned when the computer ownership in the country is 7%. There is no financial service like PayPal, zero working spaces, and no labor rights. Still, the elite who has been ruling us for years qualifies for the tax giveaways worth billions, but youth, which is already trained, acceptable to the internet market, and is already bringing money to the country, if not, tax is considered a crime. In the recently published report by Pioneer, Pakistan is ranked on fourth at freelancing, which is well above India and Bangladesh. The Bangladesh has already exempted the freelancers to promote the industry. Please note that I'm not advocating no tax here, but taxing before providing basic services is to try to strangle the market. So my question is, do we plan to learn anything from Bangladesh at all? And the last thing I want to discuss is COVID protection plan. Unfortunately, we live in a world which is infected with a fast spreading virus and many mutations. And there is clear evidence that economic growth and COVID spread are now related. Last month, I wrote a piece for Dawn, which stated that once production, supply, and logistics are sorted for the vaccination, vaccine hesitancy is going to be the next big challenge for the public health authorities, and they have to take it seriously. For starters, the document should suggest authorities making spreading misinformation on social media and messaging apps about COVID-19 should be a punishable crime. The PTA must build a platform similar to the one they have built for blasphemy. Secondly, the public health authorities should identify vaccine hesitant groups and reach the hesitant communities directly. Thirdly, there should be a collaboration with the community leaders like the imams, which can turn the vaccine distrust into trust. And to aid the process, authorities can also decide on a small monetary, non-monetary benefit for getting vaccinated. And lastly, we all need COVID Vaccine Act, which should make the vaccination a mandatory for all. There is much that can be done, but since our topic is rapid growth, so I believe these four points that I have mentioned, which is women's participation, inclusion of women, agriculture, opportunities for youth, and vaccination for COVID should be an absolute necessity. Thank you, Pyat, for making this live document. I'd like to end here. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sara. Excellent recommendations. I hope the policymakers and the people who are at the helm of affairs, they are also going to listen to your recommendations. The youth of this country and the young generation. So, Dr. Fajar, I like to make a point here, referring to what Dr. Pasha and Dr. Parvez Tahir has mentioned earlier, that the reform and growth agenda for sustained growth, that is absolutely imperative and necessary. But I think it's not sufficient because they were talking about the inclusive growth. So some senior economists like our honorable guest here and also others, which I would like to name as well, Dr. Arshad Zaman, they have raised the question of just distribution of outcomes of the higher level of growth to provinces in order to realize the realize and ensure harmony among all provinces. Otherwise, the sustainability of growth would be jeopardized in future, and which is going to be harmful to the federation as well. So this is one point which I wanted to make here and which need urgent attention, that the inclusive growth as well as the distribution of the outcomes of growth, the fruits of growth, it should be taken into account and should be part of the reform agenda as well. And so another point which I really like to make here is that the sustainable and rapid growth, we really need to introduce the initiatives to seriously combat negative environmental problems. And only green growth could ensure the sustainability and sustain in higher growth levels. So the sustainable use of all vital inputs in all production processes and growth, like water, forest products, and all natural resources, they could only ensure the sustainable higher growth rates and levels. So that also needs to be included in any reforms agenda. I think it is understanding of this kind of a problem and the other issues that already Dr. Pashar, Dr. Tahir, and our young lady here, Sara, has mentioned, they all should be considered by the people who are at the helm of affairs, who are academics, and who are basically doing research. So I like to, there is no hand here.
Well, if somebody in the audience. Let me say something. Can I say
Sir. Yes, yes. Please.
This is for the young lady you mentioned. For the young lady's information, I did say that please excuse wheat. And you can do whatever you like about sugar and sugarcane, but wheat is something different.
Please.
I was marginalized like the poor farmers. I think the police would remember that.
I fully remember.
Ajay, sir.
May I respond?
Yes, please. Okay. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Samina. And the comments here have been very insightful and would add value to the discussion. So the first thing is about inclusivity. I would say that the strategy is not only about accelerated and sustained, it's also about inclusivity. And there are various elements which point to inclusivity. Number one, the strategy talks about level playing field. So when we are saying level playing field, we want to include everyone. We want to include the marginalized, we want to include women and everyone. So inclusivity is there. Then we want to make cities inclusive. Currently in our cities, in Islamabad, at least the poor does not have a place. So when we say that let the cities go vertical, let the cities go dense, and we even go to the extent of saying that let the poor have the apartment without having the necessity to buy parking. So basically we are talking about inclusivity. And then of course there is elimination of rent seeking things. And then we are talking about street vending, which is exclusive though. So inclusivity is very much there in the report. Dr. Tahir said that Dr. Pravesta said that not much is happening, so will not happen. I will respond to this. So that's the point, that we have to constantly debate this. Only then this would happen. Sara said that, number one, women I have already talked about. Agriculture is very much there in the report. We are saying that there is no input market, there is no output market, there is no land market. There's no forward market for the agri-keys markets need to be developed. But as far as particular sectors are concerned, as I said, that we are not in favor of taking the So if you favor decentralization, then let the whole country decide, let the whole market decide which sector should be the winner. As far as opportunities for youth are concerned, as Sara already said, that we have talked about internet access. So internet access is one of the most pro-poor activity. Again, whether or not freelancing should be taxed, yes, freelancing has done wonders for Pakistan. And it is customary to incentivize budding industries and infant industries. The only argument is that for how long an industry would remain infant, as we currently say about textile or automobile. So this is a debatable point. But of course, yes, freelancing has done wonders for Pakistan, and this has to be encouraged. As far as COVID is concerned, yes, it should be COVID and growth related. But basically, this is a long-term strategy. and COVID though is going to be there for another maybe 1 or 2 years, but still, since the focus was long term, talked about COVID, on another panel has an alert platform has done a lot of research on COVID. So finally, I would say that as Dr. Tahir said, that Dr. Mubarak has mentioned, and Dr. Nadeem has also mentioned in his book, looking back, how Pakistan became Asian Tiger in 2050. So Dr. Nadeem is talking about networks, that networks are emerged, and these networks are debating issues. So is what we are doing, basically network debate. कर रहे हैं और ये इन नेटवर्क्स ने किया है कि जो स्टेट बैंक के इंडिपेंडेंस पे इन नेटवर्क्स ने इतनी बात की है कि अब शायद लगता है कि वो जो प्लान था शायद वो सक्सीड ना हो सके. तो फाइनली मैं कंक्लूड शायद कहता हूं कि आग को चाहिए एक उम्र असर होने का.
कैन आई कम इन एंड से फ्यू थिंग्स?
बड़ी मुश्किल से.
जी जी, थैंक यू.
Sara
on an extraordinarily good presentation. If this is the talent of emerging youth from ARC and IBA, I'm truly proud that we have left behind institutions which are producing such outstanding talent. Well done, Sara. And you've asked a few questions which I am compelled to answer.
Yeah,
the first is, why is it that even though particularly the provincial, if not the national assemblies, are totally dominated by the rural elites, why is it that the emphasis is not as much on agriculture as it ought to be? And why is it that we are not focusing on water development when particularly Pakistan is likely to be declared now a water scarce country? The point is the political economy of agricultural development. You see, the last thing the rural elite would want to see is the emergence of a rural middle class, the progressive kulak farmer, because that would begin to question the political domination of the landed elite in Pakistan. So they prefer, they are making good money anyway. I mean, take the example of water. Why, for example, water is not an issue for them is because most of them are at the mouth of the canals. They're right next to where the water is exiting into the system. And they are preempting the entire supply of water by and large. Water is wasted. And do you know what is our Abiana rate for our wonderful large landlords? 1,000 rupees per acre. 1,000 rupees per acre. And we are recovering 6% of the operations, maintenance, and replacement cost of the irrigation system. This is the extent of privilege that is being exercised. So that was my response. The other very important point made by Samina, which is about regional development. I have just done work with two of my PhD students on what's been happening to regional development in Pakistan. And in particular, has the 7th NFC award, which promoted significant fiscal equalization, been successful in reducing interprovincial disparities? The answer, ladies and gentlemen, is a big, big no. Balochistan has continued to fall behind despite getting twice the per capita transfer of funds from the federal government. There are all kinds of problems of institutional capacity, the power structure, the Sardari Nizam, and what have you. And the end result is, believe it or not, in the last 15 years, according to the research, the real per capita income of Balochistan has not increased. Because one, they have to contend with a population growth rate well in excess of 3%. This is the tragedy of Balochistan. And as a person who will fade away sooner or later, let me say that if we do not focus on Balochistan, which is a very much now the soft underbelly of Pakistan, the future of Pakistan's federation is clearly going to be threatened. And finally, on the youth issue, I'm glad you raised that issue. You know, the last estimates are that today in Pakistan, there are 5 million male youth who are idle, neither in the education system nor participating in the labor force because they have discouraged worker effect. On top of that, we have 7 million unmarried female youth. What a waste of national resources. The point you made. You see, what worries me, and you're beginning to see this, particularly in the large metropolitan cities, the exponential increase in the incidence of crime. I mean, in Karachi, I was told that the crime statistics, the incidence has doubled in the last 3-4 years. Yes. So, and of course, they are vulnerable to fundamentalism and totalitarianism because they cannot turn to anything else. And this is unfortunate. My own feeling was that, and of course, I've said this to the Prime Minister more than once, that the most sensitive and potentially volatile component of the population are your idle youth. And unless you begin to target them, I mean, I've given to him at least half a dozen ideas. The so-called Kamyab Jawan program is completely bogged down by lack of outreach capacity. We have to develop innovative approaches. We cannot rely on formal sector approach to the doling out of microfinance or even finance for the youth. We'll have to work with large NGOs, microfinance institutions, and so on and so forth, and develop very innovative approaches to reaching out to the youth. Believe me, I am really very, very concerned about the future of the youth of our country. So thank you for your excellent remarks, and I hope you will remain as perceptive as ever. And if you decide to move on to doing a PhD and we're there to assist you, we'll be happy to do so. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for your encouragement and support. Now we can take questions from the attendees. Varda Ajmal Looney. Varda, would you like to ask? Are you going to ask?
Assalamu alaikum, ma'am. I'm Huda Ajmaluli. Achha, I think Huda? I've joined from my daughter's account. From my daughter's account.
Are you introduce yourself, please?
Yes, ma'am. Assalamu alaikum. I'm Huda Najib Looney. I am a MPhil scholar at the AERC. I'll go back to my questions. Dr. Hafiz Pasha, you did not shed any light on the tax slabs. And a few days ago, the budget of Bangladesh was announced, and they have cut down the slabs from 7 to 5. On the comments from Sara, the Bangladesh government has actually accepted the cancers in COVID-19. So, excellent point that you raised over there. These are my comments, and one more comment I would like to add that overall the world, the discussion about internet governance and digital right to self-determination is on the rise, and we are just only beginning in the world of internet. So I would like Swarm Agenda to add these key points to that. Without governance, without internet governance, taxing freelancers is not a good idea. There needs to be a discussion and debates on how internet can be governed. What are the internet governance systems? If I'm an individual, I have a virtual presence on internet, I need to have some laws, rules and regulation. I need to have some rights. I need to know where my privacy is. The question of privacy and how my data is being used. Can I sell my own data if I want to sell my data? I think these are the debates that are happening all over the world, and these should be also included. included in the reform agenda. That's what I wanted to say. Thank you.
Can I respond to the tax slabs question?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Good question. And let me tell you a little bit about yet another wonderful aspect of our personal income tax system. Pakistan is the only country in the world which has 11 slabs. 11. India has 5, Bangladesh has 6, and we have 11 slabs. And do you know that where the highest rate applies 35% on personal income, it applies only on those who have an annual income of only rupees 75 million per annum, namely 60 lakh rupees per month. So in effect, the progressivity of the personal income tax system is lost because it is stretched out so much. So when I spoke to the Prime Minister, and this is fortunately one idea of mine which has been picked up, I have suggested three things. One, 6 slabs, raise the exemption limit because our middle class is also suffering due to high inflation. We had earlier on already raised it and then withdrew it. Raise it from 600,000 rupees per annum to 1,200,000 rupees per annum, which is what we had done 2 years ago and withdrawn it. Bring it back to 1,200,000, have 5 slabs, and the maximum should be attained when the income level is 15, not 75 million rupees. Let us see whether this will come out in the budget or not. They have been talking about reducing slabs, so I'm waiting anxiously to see if this proposal goes through. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much for the comment. And I see no other hand. Nobody is going to ask any question, not willing to. So, and we have already crossed the limited time that we had. And I think it's time to say thank you to all of my panelists, very worthy panelists, Dr. Hafiz Pasha. You are with us on the webinar, but it seems to me as if you are at the AERC. And you know, yes. The AERC is your home, so you are at,
yes,
your home.
So thank you. Should I thank you
because you are already at your home. So
absolutely.
So,
keep up your good work. Samina, you're doing outstanding work. Keep it up.
Thank you so much. Thank you for your support and your kind words. I treasure your support, always.
Thank you.
And Dr. Khaja, thank you so much. And it's an excellent presentation that you have done of the work that PIDE has already come up with, a very good document. And I think what your objectives basically are, they would be realized in future, and a lot of debate and research work would be undertaken by the different institutions and think tanks. That would be basically good for the country as well. But this time, sir, AERC is also not unknown for you, and you have been to our conferences. You have been a wonderful, wonderful guest of honor for us, the AERC. Thank you so much for your time.
You.
And Sarah is our own student.
At least you were able to provoke Hafiz, and we were able to get something out of him.
Okay.
Thank you, Dr. Samina, for this opportunity and organizing this great panel.
Please say congratulations, Dr. Khaja, to Dr. Nadeemul Haq, because he has done a wonderful job in producing this document. Thank you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Pasha and Dr. Pervez Tahir and Farah.
Thank you. Allah Hafiz.
Allah Hafiz.
Thank you, Sarah.